Hello students, welcome to this session on research critique. Critique is a critical discussion of a particular topic and many terms are being used. For example, critical analysis, critical review, critical evaluation, critical appraisal. So all these terms are interchangeably used with research critique. And the outcome of critique is not going to be a negative grilling to identify all of the shortcomings, because each and every report needs to be assessed with a critical eye towards each unique setting. Learning outcomes. By the end of the lecture, students will be able to get a basic understanding of the critical review of published research article, familiarize with the elements and guidelines in critiquing a research article, to understand the importance of critiquing research findings for nursing practice. Research critique is a careful judgment in which you give your opinion about the good and the bad parts of something. It is a mechanism to provide feedback for improvement. So no study is ever perfectly conducted. Multiple methodological judgments are needed to be made as they influence the significance of the outcomes. Research. So what is research critique? It is a systematic, unbiased, careful examination of all aspects of a study to judge the merits, limitations, meaning, and significance based on previous research experience and knowledge of the topic. Critiquing is a systematic method of appraising the strengths and limitations of a piece of research in order to determine its credibility and its applicability to the practice, because not all published research is scientifically sound. Purposes. So why do we do the research critiquing? What are the purposes of critiquing? The main purpose is to determine whether the findings of the research are usable for you, to highlight the strengths and weaknesses of the study, to help in deciding whether to publish the study or not, to provide feedback for the improvement in the study, to implement evidence-based practice in nursing, to find out methodological flaws in the research, to be used in the clinical areas, to contribute to the body of nursing knowledge and profession. Major areas of critiquing. Necessary elements in a research critique can be compiled into a series of questions, and the areas could be literature review, which has been reviewed for the study, research methodology, which is used for the study, conceptual framework or theoretical framework, results or findings of the research study, discussion of the research findings or results, ethical considerations to be kept in mind. These are the major areas which will be used for critiquing. The process of conducting a research critique. The critiquing process should begin with reading the entire study to get an overview and appreciate its contribution to the knowledge development. So first of all, you have to read the full article to get an overview of the article. To understand comprehension of all the aspects of the research process, to understand all the aspects, organize them, and then presentation also need to be examined, all the aspects. All the chapters needs to be analyzed with focused examination, comparison of the report with the ideal study. So this has to be compared with the ideal study rules, how an ideal research study should be like. The sole motive of critiquing is to improve the practice and broaden the understanding. Dimensions. So what are the dimensions of critiquing research? Substantive dimensions, methodological dimensions, ethical dimensions, interpretive dimensions, presentation dimensions, and practical dimensions. So substantive. Substantive means significant or meaningful or essential. So it means how significant is the problem to nursing profession? How important is the problem for solving the current issues? Methodological dimensions. So does the, is it identify clearly, identify the variables in measurable terms? Is the nature of population to be studied, defining the type of particular study, methodological issues? Is it worthy in terms of significance? Ethical dimensions. So does it require the use of human subjects? Does the research problem imply potential risks for the subjects? Interpretive means it includes the research findings, discussion, conclusions, implications towards the end of the study. Does it make sense of the analysis? Findings, do the findings support or they fail to support the hypothesis? Presentation dimensions, for example, or presentation or stylistic dimensions. Is the problem statement complete, concise, clear in a declarative form? Is the writing style good? Unnecessary jargon is minimized. It is written in a passive voice. Practical, so is the problem too big or too complex for the investigation? Is the researcher able to manage the resources, man, money, materials, and also permissions from the competent authorities? So these are the dimensions of critiquing research. Types of critiques. So there are 9 types of critiques. Number 1, student critiques. Number 2, practicing nurses. Number 3, educators, nurse researchers, abstract reviewers, participants at the conferences or workshops. Journals critique articles, an article in a peer-reviewed journal, and then request for the funding research. So it ranges. There are 9 types of critiques. The types of critiques range from a student critique to critiques of research proposals. So the student critique learns to critique the research in their nursing education programs. The practicing nurses, they analyze research studies for evidence-based care. The educators, they approach research critique from the aspect of improving the instructions. The nurse researchers, they focus on research studies in their own specific areas, wherever they are working. Abstract reviewers, so abstracts are reviewed for the use in research findings. Participants at the conferences, when you're presenting research at the conferences, workshops, to allow the critique in the as an oral presentation or in the conferences and workshops. Journals, critique articles. So the journals allow for the critiquing, and it is published for published article. They allow the authors to respond, and it is in the form of a letters to the editors. An article in a peer-reviewed journal, for example, articles are submitted for publications and they have to undergo critiquing process. So peer review to assess the quality of the study. So request for funding research, final to obtain funding for the research studies from the agencies, for example, Indian Council of Medical Research. So critiquing is very essential for evidence-based practice. Key aspects of the critique: understanding the problem and purpose while determining if the design and methodology of study are they consistent with the purpose. Determining if the methodology adopted is properly applied depending on the nature of the study. Assessing if the outcomes and conclusions they are believable and supported by the findings. Reflecting on overall quality, strengths and limitations. So these are the key aspects of the critique to be kept in mind. Guidelines for critiquing a research report. Researcher to maintain objectivity, supportive, constructive, balanced. So these are the 4 approaches. So the researcher needs to maintain an objectivity right through the critiquing process and does not express any personal views. So it has to be supportive and encouraging. All the comments needs to be given supportive, constructive suggestions, and also a positive attitude. Balanced approach to keep strengths and the weaknesses points while giving report or the comments. And they need to provide reasons and explanations when they're submitting the weak points. And they need to select only clear statements to communicate. So critiquing guidelines are very essential and they need to be followed while evaluating the research reports. Guidelines for critiquing. Read out the entire study carefully to understand and get an overview. Identify the terms that you do not understand or do not follow, or you need more clarification. Examine the organization of the report and also the presentation. Explain about the strengths and weaknesses of the study. Maintain objectivity throughout the critiquing process. Justify your comments by giving examples. Use clear, concise, and positive statements. Choose encouraging and motivating words and sentences. Avoid general vague statements and also fault findings. Provide suggestions with negative comments. So negative comments to be followed with suggestions. Rules for an ideal study. Research problem, for example, so it should have significance of the problem, clarification of the study, of the aim of the study, practicality of the study, clarity, significance, and documentation. Now, coming to review of literature, the organization of literature should be into headings and subheadings, rationale and direction for the study, progression towards the study question, conceptual framework or theoretical framework. There should be a clear link between conceptual framework and the research question or the purpose, any maps or models which are logically presented. Research question hypothesis should be expressed appropriately and clearly. It should be logically related to the research purpose and the framework. Variables. So variables need to be operationally defined. Concepts to be defined within the framework. Conceptual definition should be consistent with the operational definition of each variable. Research design. So design should be appropriate. Clearly defined protocol should be evident. Threats to internal validity need to be minimized. It should be logically connected to the sampling method. Sampling method must be appropriate to result in representative sample. Biases should be identified. Human rights need to be protected. Setting should be described and it should be appropriate for the target population. Measurements, instruments or the tools should be sufficient for measuring the variables. Instruments validity and reliability levels to be checked. Instrument scoring techniques to be clearly described. Data collection techniques for using observation clearly described. Methods for recording measures clearly stated. Inter-rater reliability described. Process clearly, consistently, and ethically described. Data analysis, the procedures which are suitable to the type of data collected. Analysis procedures need to be clearly portrayed. Outcomes offered in a comprehensible way. So this was the rules for an ideal study. Contents to be critiqued. Researchers' qualifications, title, abstract, introduction, objectives, problem statement, review of literature, conceptual framework, limitations, hypothesis, operational definitions, research design, ethical considerations, population and sample, data collection methods, data collection instruments, data analysis, results, discussion of the findings, conclusion, implications, recommendations, and other considerations. So these are the contents which will be critiqued. Researchers' qualifications or authors' credentials. For example, who conducted the research, including their job titles, and also the author's credentials or the qualifications should indicate the principal investigator and the co-investigators. Does the author have the necessary knowledge and skills to do the research? Is the author qualified to undertake the research? Does the title has the name of the author or authors? their qualifications and affiliations. What is the job title of the author? How legitimate is the source of the research article? For example, an empirical study from a peer-reviewed journal or an article from a magazine. So which is more legitimate out of these? Research title. So it indicates what the research is all about. Is the title clear, accurate, and unambiguous? Does it clearly specify the purpose of the study? Is it short, between 10 to 15 words long? Does the title of the research report identifies the major study variables and the population under study? Is it self-explanatory and concise? Does it mention what, when, and where of the research? So this was about the title. Abstract. So what is an abstract? It is the study. What is the study about? The length could be 200 or to 300 words. Has it provided a snapshot of the study? Is the research abstract clearly written? It provides a brief summary of the article. Does it explain and why the research was carried out? What is the major theme of the research study? How relevant is the research in terms of topic, population, and methodology? So it has to be an independent in itself, the abstract. Does the abstract offer a clear overview of the study, including research problem, sample, methodology, findings, and recommendations? Introduction. So introduction talks about the background of the study, and also it states relevant background information and justifies the study. Should contain a statement of the problem, background, objectives, hypothesis, significance of the study with the recent references. It must mention the conceptual framework or theoretical framework. Every key word in the study must be defined clearly, operationally, and conceptually. Was it indicated why the study was undertaken? Is the purpose of the study presented? Is the significance of the problem discussed? Whether the key words were defined operationally? Objectives. Is the problem statement clearly articulated? So what was the purpose of this study? Are the objectives stated in clear and concise form? Was there a clear need for the study? Are the objectives in accordance with the research problem? Is it relevant to your practice? Will the study add to the body of literature? Will the study improve nursing practice? So are the objectives stated using accepted action verbs in the logical manner? Problem statement. Is the problem statement clear and concise? Is the problem significant for the nursing profession? Is the problem researchable? Is the research problem within the professional domain? Is there a justification for the study? Does it clearly depict variables, population, place of the study? It has to be a single declarative or interrogative sentence. Is it feasible to study in reference to time, resources, researchers' ability, and availability of the respondents? So what is the research problem? What problem existed that the researcher attempted to address in this setting, or in terms of a lack of research or a need for the further research? Is the problem too big or too small? Because both can be confusing or misleading. Does it have relevant background information? Does it have the potential to help solve a current problem in the clinical practice? Review of literature. Is the literature review clearly organized, concisely written, and logically developed? Because it gives an overview of the available literature. It establishes what is known and what is not known about the research problem. So is the literature mainly from the primary sources or of an empirical nature? Is the current knowledge about the problem described? Is there a clear relationship between the literature and the problem being studied, well organized under subheadings and also in a chronological order. Is the literature review comprehensive? Does it include an introduction and the summary? Are the most relevant and recent studies included within the last 5 years? Are the references cited accurately? Is it presented in an analytical way to draw the meaningful inferences? Is there over-dependence on secondary sources? Does it identify the gaps in the knowledge and supports necessity of the present study? Conceptual framework. It has a conceptual or theoretical framework. Has it been identified? Is the conceptual or theoretical framework applicable to the research in accordance to the research problem? Is a rationale stated for the theoretical or conceptual framework? Is the framework clearly developed? Framework clearly developed and described, because it guides the study by providing framework and also sets the boundaries. So are the relevant variables defined operationally, and also they are expressed in measurable terms? Has the theoretical basis for hypothesis formulation been stated clearly? Is the problem linked to conceptual framework in a natural way? Limitations. So have the limitations been identified and mentioned in the research report? Have they been considered while stating limitations? Nature of the data collection, instruments utilized, sampling technique, and also the time constraints. Have methodological limitations been specified? For example, single setting study, unrepresentative sample in the study, weak design, limited control over treatment implementation, measuring instruments with limited validity and reliability, and limited control over data collection. Hypothesis. Is the hypothesis stated clearly, precisely, and appropriately? Do they flow logically? Are they specific and testable? Are all the variables described? Do they relate to the aims, purposes, and theory? Do they include the general population of interest? Does the hypothesis reflect the purpose of the study? Are they stated in a form that permits them to be tested? Measurable terms and also the level of significance being mentioned. Does it express a predictable relationship? Operational definitions. Are all the terms, concepts, and theories mentioned in the study clearly defined? Are all the study variables operationally defined? Are operational definitions stated in logical and measurable form? Are the concepts clearly and operationally defined? Has the population of the study been defined operationally? Operational definitions. Research design methodology. So it states what researcher had done and how was it done. It describes the participants, the materials, and also the procedures. It is the heart of the study, research methodology. Are the relevant variables from being operationally defined? So it is literally the nuts and bolts of it, how a study is being undertaken. So what was the specific research design used? Is the type of research design identified? Is the design appropriate to answer the research problem? Question, does the research design fit appropriately according to the variables and purpose of the study? Was the pilot study undertaken? Is it designed to infer the cause and effect relationship between the variables? If it is an experimental design, what methods are used to control internal and external threats to the validity? Ethical considerations. So, were the rights of human beings protected? Was the ethical clearance obtained from the Institutional Ethical Committee? Were the ethical standards maintained? Because it has four fundamental moral principles to be kept in mind. Autonomy, that's the right to participate in the study. non-maleficence, that means not harming the participants and preventing harm. Beneficence, benefiting participants and the society as a whole. So no physical harm or psychological harm. Justice, treating all as equals. So no preferential treatment to any of the groups. There are four moral rules to be kept in mind: truthfulness, loyalty and trust, confidentiality, and privacy. Population and sample. Is the sample representative of the population? So it describes the number of participants, the characteristics of the participants, and also their selection process. So is this sample representative of the population? Is the target population and accessible population clearly defined, identified? Was the sampling method and subjects described? Was the suitable sampling method selected to answer the research question? Was the sample size justified to obtain the valid results? Is the setting described in the study? And is it appropriate for the target population? Are the key characteristics described? Have the potential sampling biases been identified by the researcher? Sample and sampling technique. Is there adequate assurance that the rights of the human subjects were protected? Was the response rate reported? Has the inclusion criteria and exclusion criteria been clearly identified? Has the subject dropout been explained? Was the method of choosing sample, that is probability or non-probability method, appropriate? Who is included, for example, adults and children, and who is excluded, elderly and pregnant women, to be clearly spelled out. This was sample and sampling technique. Data collection methods. So data collection procedure is a step by, to be explained in a step-by-step manner. So are the data collection method described clearly? Are the data collection methods appropriate? Are the relevant variables clearly defined? Has the researcher mentioned the problems faced with the methods of data collection? If there were more than one data collector, was the inter-data reliability adequate and were they all given adequate training? Was the procedure for preventing contamination between the treatment and the control group described? How often was the data collected and for how long was the data collected? This was about the data collection methods. Data collection instruments. So details of suitable instruments to measure the study variables. It should clearly describe the scoring techniques as well. So are the appropriate instruments used for data collection? Is validity and reliability of the instruments adequate? Are the instruments described sufficiently? Is there an evidence for validity and reliability of the instruments? Was the pilot study conducted using the same instruments? Were the items in the instruments appropriate to collect the adequate data? Were all the subjects administered instruments uniformly? Were the instructions clear and adequate to complete the questionnaire? Data analysis and the results. So it contains the main results and the findings. So suitable analysis procedures to be adopted. So is the choice of statistical procedures appropriate for the methodology proposed, for the sample size, sampling method, and the hypothesis? Are the sample characteristics described? Are the results for each hypothesis clearly and objectively presented? Are the tables and figures used to present the data? Is analysis consistent with the objectives? Are they labeled clearly and used efficiently to highlight the presentation of results? Do the results make sense? Are the results described with the supporting literature? Is each hypothesis addressed? Is adequate information presented related to the statistical tests used? Is there any omissions of the results or repetition? Does the interpretation of the results fit with the other components of the study? Were there any unexpected findings? has the text complemented the tables and the figures? This is about the results. Discussion of the findings. So they interpret the results in relation to the research question, and it has a clear statement whether they are supporting or not supporting the hypothesis. It also includes the results of the other studies. So it should highlight the most important results, and they should be relevant and useful to the practice. So are the findings related to the previous literature? Are all the important results discussed? Is the identified hypothesis supported or not? Are the major findings highlighted? Does the discussion cover all the debatable aspects of the study? Are the findings clearly described? Is the discussion related to the present study? Is the interpretation organized in a meaningful fashion? Were the strengths, limitations, and generalizability of the study discussed? Conclusion. So conclusion summarizes the main points and it indicates the usefulness of the research. Does the discussion fit with the data? Has the study concluded precisely and concisely with the most significant findings? Are the conclusions based on the results of the study and also related to the hypothesis? Were the main points drawn out? Are the conclusions related to the study design and objectives? Is it written in an interesting manner? Are generalizations made within the scope of the findings? Implications. So are the implications appropriate? Are the implication of findings discussed? For example, are they discussed separately for the practice, for the education, and for the administration? Research utilization implications. For example, does the study meet the criteria of replicability? Is the study relevant for practice? Is the study feasible to implement? Does the benefits of the study outweigh the risks? Recommendations. So are the recommendations based on the research findings? Are practical recommendations made towards improvements in the nursing practices? Are recommendations made with suggested changes in the methodologies for the future research on the similar topic? Are recommendations consistent with the research findings and the results? Are recommendations made for practical applications? Other considerations. It should be interesting to read, grammatically correct, and in simple sentences. Is the report clear and understandable? Writing style to be formal and impersonal. It should be well written, grammatically correct, and without any jargons. And there should not be any complex sentences. Should attract the reader to read on the research article. Has the source of funding been mentioned? Bibliography or references. Are all the references relevant and completely follow the recommended style of writing? Were all referred books and journals for the study referred accurately? Do contents of the report show appropriate references? Is the reference list comprehensive? Are the number of references adequate and current? Does it cover the breadth and the length of the literature? Have different types of references been used? Have references been listed in numerical order in the text? Are there no omissions of citations in the text and bibliography? Are there spelling mistakes in quoting the author or the journal names? Is the title name, year, volume, number, and page number incorrect? So how it has been identified? References. Now, critiquing qualitative research, the next section. Qualitative research, the critique of qualitative research is slightly different from the quantitative because research is done in the natural settings. Qualitative research. Qualitative researchers, they are interested in knowing how people interpret their own experiences, how they construct their worlds, and what meaning do they give to their experiences. There is no hypothesis to guide the study in qualitative research. Qualitative studies use a small sample, purposive sample, and there may not be a conceptual framework. They use unstructured instruments and results are in words, in the form of words. So is the phenomena of interest clearly identified? Has it been identified why the phenomena requires a qualitative format? Standards. So what are the standards to evaluate qualitative studies? Descriptive vividness, methodological approach, analytical and interpretive preciseness, theoretical connectedness, heuristic relevance. So descriptive vividness, what is descriptive vividness? The study purpose The study purpose, significance, interpretations must be written in details. It should be a very rich data. The threats to descriptive vividness could be failure to include essential descriptive information, lack of clarity in the description, inadequate analysis and interpretation, important features, either they are being left out or they are not discussed completely. So this was one, descriptive vividness. Methodological approach used, whether it was consistent with the philosophical basis of the study. Methodological excellence has four dimensions. Adequate documentation of the participants. There's a detailed description of the participants, rationale for selecting those participants, and the location where the study was conducted or the site. Careful attention to the procedural growth approach. Adherence to the ethical standards, auditability, that means to follow the conclusions of the researcher, establish the confirmability that findings are based on participants' narratives. Analytical and interpretive preciseness. So the analytic process involves a series of interpretations and then transformations through which the data is transformed and the outcome imparts meaning to the phenomena. So the interpreter or the researcher has to involve in the interpretive process and present a meaningful picture of the phenomena. Theoretical connectedness. Or philosophical connectedness, it requires that the findings are developed from the study. They should be logically consistent, they should be clearly expressed, and they need to be compatible with the knowledge base of the profession. For example, methodological procedures adopted, analytical approach adopted must be consistent with the theoretical basis of the study. Heuristic relevance, that means the reader's ability to recognize the phenomena which is described in the study, its applicability to the nursing practice and influence on the future research. This has dimensions like intuitive recognition. That means readers immediately they recognize that particular phenomena which is studied and their own connection with the personal experiences and relationship to the practice. Relationship to the existing body of knowledge. So there is similarities between the current knowledge base and the study findings. And also it is applicability to the nursing practice, nursing research and nursing education. So these were the standards to evaluate the qualitative studies. A critique emphasizes all the elements of the research process. A critique is not 100% critical. Most of the part may be positive comments only. One needs to focus on the most potential problems. It is a critical review or a commentary. The intellectual critique has to evaluate the creation and not the creator. Seeking only criticism is not a critique. So reviewer has to maintain objectivity throughout the process. It has to be an impersonal scrutiny. Critique of qualitative research. What is qualitative study design? What is the phenomena of interest? Is the research setting or the environment described or the site being described wherever the study is undertaken? Do the problem and the purpose match the research question? Or also, what is the significance of the topic? To focus on subjective nature of human experiences, are the ethical considerations stated? For example, the researcher's participant relationship, the role of the researcher, and researcher's biases. Is appropriate rationale provided for the purposive sample? So, were the data collection approaches appropriate for the study's purpose? For example, interviews, observation and questionnaire method of data collection. Are the data analysis steps clearly described? Are the categories and the themes presented and supported with clarity for the reader in analysis? Does the researcher integrate his thoughts from the field notes that he will be writing in the field? Are the study's limitations being identified? Is the data trustworthy and dependable? Sampling. Does the researcher describe the selection of the participants? Is purposive sampling used? Are the informants who were chosen appropriate for the research? Is protection of human participants addressed? Is saturation of data by the subjects described? Data analysis. Have the data analysis procedures been described? Has the researcher remained true to the data? Has credibility, auditability, and fittingness been explained? Do the participants recognize the experiences as their own? So that is credibility. Has the research process been documented? Auditability. Can the findings be applicable outside the study situation? Are the results meaningful to individuals who are not involved in the research? Is the reader able to grasp the essence of the experiences from the report? Does the researcher offer recommendations for the future study in different setting of a different samples? Examples of critical comments. Omission of relevant information, sometimes it may be left out. Narrow subject focus. Poor data collection methods. Lack of current data. Exaggerated claims. Confusion between correlation and causation. Lack of evidence to support the conclusions. Challenge to the validity of conclusions. Challenge to the generalizability of conclusions. So these are some of the critical comments which are used. Conclusion. The research critique is essential to identify what is the best practice. The process of critiquing involves an in-depth examination of each stage of the research process. It is a scrutiny of a piece of work using a balanced and objective approach to identify whether it is trustworthy and unbiased. Nursing practice is becoming more evidence-based, so it is important that care has its foundations in the sound research. Ability to accomplish critical appraisals is a skill that must be developed through repeated practice. That's all about research critique. Thank you, students.